As promised, The Lighthouse. This video is the second part of my review, and I will be spoiling major plot points of the film, so if you haven't watched the film or my first review, please watch the movie and my spoiler-free review first. Right off the bat, the sheer number of ambiguity distinctly tells the audience that this film is intentionally open for interpretation, and so I'm just here to point out some of the apparent symbols and potential translation of said symbols so that you may come up with your own conclusions. So more than any other times, these are my personal thoughts and are not necessarily correct or the only available interpretation. So, where do we begin? Willem Dafoe? Pattinson? Mermaid? No, it all starts in the very beginning. Cinematography. Why do you think Eggers chose to shoot this movie in 1:19:1 aspect ratio with a 35mm black and white film? On the first sight, The Lighthouse seems like an esoteric work of art and just that. However, these cinematic elements are not merely present for the sake of art, but are a very intentional part of Eggers' vision. Compare this work to Eggers' previous movie, The Witch, which took itself overly serious in my opinion, but kept its cinematography as realistic as possible, shooting with natural lights, using candles to light the scene, and display the crushing atmosphere as plainly as one can. There was no pretending, everything was as it was, as it should have been with the direction the movie was taking. The Lighthouse is the complete opposite. Given that Jaron Blaschke was the director of photography for both movies, everything must have been a premeditated choice. Eggers even mentions himself that the movie is about laughing at misery. So what purpose so critical do the ratio and the color choice serve to decide on balancing that out with comedy rather than taking them out altogether? Simply put, it's all about perspective. The story is told by Robert Pattinson's Ephraim Winslow. I have mentioned in my previous video about the 19th century setting of the film and the general dread that are supported by the ratio and the black and white shots. But where is the dread coming from? If you think back, the story is told almost entirely from Winslow's perspective, hence the mystery of the light to begin with. Given his true identity, his discomfort around Willem Dafoe's Thomas Wake, and his general personality, it's obvious that he would feel trapped and uncomfortable. Add to that the small rooms, low ceilings, small tables, small kitchen, nosy Thomas, and nowhere to hide. The boxy ratio is literally screaming, "I am trapped and cannot breathe," as well as visually depicting the space or lack thereof the two characters are set in. But wait, you may say? The movie felt very wide and overwhelming at times as well. For example, at scenes when Winslow is working outdoor and looks at the ocean, the shore, or any scenes outside, the shots seem wider and more imposing than before. And you're right. But that's also because of the perspective. Since I mentioned I believe the choice of 1:19:1 was made to convey a sense of discomfort, I believe the sense of wideness is also directly related to Winslow's psychological state rather than it existing only for technical boasting and visual feasts. The concept of the ocean is very conflicting to where they reside as lighthouse keepers, and accordingly, the wide and endless delineation of the outdoors is only suitable. But it also tells us Winslow's desire to escape the circumstance and how lost and overpowered and perhaps even helpless he feels against the ocean. The ocean itself may be very synonymous to the idea of God or the one in control of this world and this movie with its grandiosity. For now, just note that the term God is used very loosely and it's really anything synonymous to the idea of it. And so what better simultaneously comedic and horrifying way to introduce the angels of God, if you will, than to use seagulls. Thomas tells Winslow in the movie that the sea birds are not to be messed with, that the souls of the dead sailors are reincarnated in the form of a seagull. The seagull that constantly follows Pattinson, if you noticed, has only one eye, just like the dead sailor he finds in the fishnet, and like how he ends up on the shore at the end with, you guessed it, his eyes pecked out. Regardless of whether the imagery of the sailor is true or not, the concept is proven by director's decision to have it in, and is fascinating enough. Eggers is known to be a big fan of Edgar Allan Poe, and so the seagulls reminded me of his narrative poem Raven as well. The fact that the seagull was pestering Winslow constantly, one can question if it was a warning, a sinister play of the dead, or something else. But either way, Winslow reacts inappropriately by killing the seagull, and that's the pivotal point in the narrative where all things go wrong for him. the vast ocean, seagulls towing Winslow, a small human being that has no choice but to be stripped naked by the grandness of the world, exposed to his core. Do you sense it yet? One of the most prominent themes of this movie is power and the struggle for its security. Once you start watching the scenes through this lens, you realize that everything in this movie is about fighting for dominance. Even before we expand to the contrasting level of power between the ocean and the lighthouse keepers, every interaction between the two puny humans, Thomas and Winslow themselves, is revealed to be about the same fight, centered around the symbolic lighthouse. As the movie starts, Thomas clearly establishes his superiority over Winslow by affirming his role as the lightkeeper, while instructing Winslow to take care of all other trivial tasks. Frankly, Thomas seems a bit off from the start anyways, but he absolutely crosses the line every time Winslow even hints the idea of him potentially being near the light. Thomas goes berserk like an insane person, becomes overly commanding, and goes as far as to call Winslow a dog. Why? Winslow witnesses Thomas at the top of the lighthouse naked, seemingly in great pleasure, with facial expression of someone experiencing a spiritual epiphany, almost as if the light is the gateway to God. Thomas is overprotective of the light because one must acquire the needed wisdom and maturity through experience and time to finally reach the light. He even directly mentions to Winslow that one day Winslow may even become a lightkeeper himself. But for now, Winslow stays at the base of the lighthouse, noisy, dirty, and dark, portrayed like hell, while Thomas stays at the top, which looks like heaven. If you think about the biblical concept of Holy of Holies, the inner sanctuary of the tabernacle, where God's presence appeared and how it was covered by a veil, and to be entered only by the high priest once a year, you may be able to tolerate this exaggerated respect toward the lighthouse. With this analogy in mind, Thomas would be the high priest entering the tabernacle, the lighthouse, to meet God, so to speak. It's even more alluring to realize that in the Bible, the main reason for the installation of the veil before the Holy of Holies was to protect the people from accidentally witnessing God, just like how there is a locked door to stop Winslow from reaching the light. It is stated in the Bible that directly confronting God himself will result in death due to the sinful nature of humans and God's contradictory character of overwhelming, almost unbearable holiness. We will get to this soon, but Winslow too, a man with a sinful past, reaches the light, falls down the stairs, and meets his tragic end. The locked door doesn't even really open by the key in the movie, or at least not painted that way when Winslow finally kills Thomas and takes the key. It just kind of magically opens when the key is pushed in, illustrating how the key in its material sense may not actually matter in reaching the light. It's the accumulated wisdom and earned responsibility for the power that allows one to dance with it. Winslow doesn't have the necessary skills to wield this light and gets consumed instead. Now, I doubt that this exact notion of tabernacle is relevant to what Eggers was going for, but the general idea of a higher power is absolutely present and are typically regular across the spectrum of different religions. And Christianity, for me, is the most familiar religion to perceive and dissect this symbol, so let's take it as an interesting analogy and just that. So anyways, with such hierarchical and strict relationship, you start to wonder how these two men are ever going to get along. Well, they don't. Although they may eat and talk to each other face to face, eye to eye, leveled and ostensibly equal, if Thomas gets psychologically cornered, he stands up. And notice how the camera doesn't stand up with him. It stays at Winslow's level at its low angle composition, cluing the notion of power difference that still exists at the core of their relationship. But soon you see them drink and get along more than just fine. Alcohol is another brilliant item used to shed light on the subject of power dynamics. The rank difference is such a huge one that an interaction at an equal stance is near impossible without the help from a downer. Even then, with seemingly innocent chit-chats, Thomas opening up to Winslow and Winslow even slightly changing accents, although that may just be what I felt, there are still battles in its own form when both are drunk. Through dancing and singing, they shift the violent power fight in a more whimsical way. Eventually, when they run out of alcohol and mix and take kerosene, a potentially life-threatening poison, or a drug in this case, The gap seems even smaller, and their power struggle becomes almost sexual. And since the concept of power is indeed very close to the concept of sexuality and its hierarchical chemistry or roleplay even, every imagery that could be interpreted as a power struggle may likewise be interpreted as an endeavor for sexual gratification. Let's go back a little bit. First off, the lighthouse itself is very sexual. The actual script of the movie explicitly states that the lighthouse is shaped like an erect penis. Thomas is the only one who has access to that lighthouse, while Winslow manages all the domestic, stereotypical feminine work. And seeing Thomas up there naked and possibly pleasuring himself is pretty in your face. Finally, the dog title can also be regarded as a sexual tension. When Winslow finally gets the upper hand, the first thing he tells Thomas is to bark like a dog. And if you view the main conflict as being sexual, that's where Siren, or Mermaid, comes into the scene more naturally. Pattinson, being the weaker, submissive, inferior one on the island, wishes to seek dominance as well as to relieve himself of the dreadful loneliness caused by isolation and guilt. Siren is not only a bad symbol for sailors, but they are described as being very beautiful. It may simply be a foreshadowing of his doom, but he is definitely looking for a way to feel power, love, and sexual gratification, as evident by his masturbation scene. Okay, so let's focus back on power. This theme becomes even more evident when Winslow finally opens up about his true identity. There are still lines not to be crossed, and Thomas obsessively tells Winslow not to spill his beans. It may simply be that Thomas wants to stay professional, but really? By spilling the beans, their relationship inevitably becomes more horizontal than vertical, and that is not supposed to happen. If I must consider the former hypothesis, it still yields the same theory. Staying professional for Thomas would be equivalent to not caring enough to be swayed. The more Thomas must care about Winslow, the more equal their relationship becomes, and this increases the chance of Thomas being distracted from his duty, protecting the light at all costs. So instead, what happens next? As one can guess from his farts, he is the one gaslighting Winslow throughout, lying about the time spent on the island, getting him drunk before the departing day, dropping Winslow from the lighthouse and leaving him be, dominantly pushing him to the edge, chasing him with an axe only to say it was Winslow, etc. Of course, by this point, we as an audience do not know who to trust and what is real, and maybe it doesn't even matter. Robert Eggers, the director, made sure to keep Pattinson's stubble more or less the same length every day. Almost as if we are supposed to be unaware of the true timeline and reality of this world, as if we are to be in Winslow's shoes, going back to that perspective thing. Regardless, the guilt of murder weighs down on Winslow, as illustrated from his dreams of drowning under the logs, seeing the real Winslow, and ironically killing Thomas with an axe at the end once he loses it all. Okay, now's a good time to finally mention the Greek mythology symbols and how they are not central. It rather serves as a wrapper to nicely wrap up the story and its main themes. Winslow's power struggle and wish of stealing the light works well with the idea of Prometheus, a titan who steals fire from the gods and gets punished eternally by being bound to a rock, having his liver eaten by an eagle only to have it grow back the next day to be eaten again. Winslow ends up on the shore with the same fate, just with a seagull instead of an eagle. And Thomas as a shape-shifting sea god Proteus, also known as the Old Man of the Sea, which is very fitting, gaslighting and confusing Winslow, as well as playing the role of god in control, at least more than Winslow, and the fact that he perhaps shifted not only into an octopus but the siren itself, evident in the fight scene, simply presents and further supports the idea of relationship between Winslow and the siren, displaying his struggle with inferiority as mentioned before. Many consider the Greek mythology symbols to be the main gimmick of the movie, but to me these are extra cushion for support, not the central nucleus. Take one great scene from the movie, specifically of Thomas shooting lasers out of his eyes to Winslow in Winslow's dream as he stares up at his glittering eyes in fear. This is a nice picture to emphasize Winslow's desire for the light and how Thomas is in control. Many different interpretations can grow from this single imagery, but did you know that this scene stems primarily from Eggers' love for Sascha Schneider, a German artist, and is therefore a mere replication adaptation of his work, Hypnosis. Yes, it may be relevant to the film, but my point is not all symbols have to carry significant weight. Of course, the same applies for all the other symbols that I have discussed thus far. All very interesting nonetheless. Okay, so where does this lead to? What conclusive message could summarize this journey? Winslow steals a man's life, his identity, and without repaying for his sins, tries to run. How far? Look at the antagonistic nature of his job choices. He decides to be a wiki from being a timberman. That's how far. Mentally speaking, he has run to the ends of the earth to disregard his sinful acts, to cheat time and beat the suffering that is necessary to pay his debt. That's perhaps why Thomas has negatively described Winslow in his notes, seemingly from the start, despite Winslow doing a decent job at all tasks at hand. One simply cannot cheat God. Winslow was out from the start. And even there, before such information was revealed to him, Winslow tries to steal the light, whatever it may really represent, to skip the steps that must be stepped to reach the top, the responsibility, the power, the ladder that every human being must learn to climb. What good does it do to possess the light if you never went through the hardship to mature, through tearful repentance, to truly grow into a better human being? The answer is nothing, as living itself will become nothing but an eternal suffering, hell. And as always, that's it for me.